Chartered accountancy is a big deal. There's no doubt about that. And if you have any doubts, please check LinkedIn. The sheer number of people that share their mark sheets and the Shakespearean ballad of their preparations which they describe. Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, YouTube, kahi pe bhi jao, you won't miss the celebration. And on top of that, people who have cleared 5 years back, even 10 years back also, they'll jump in the bandwagon, and Facebook has the share a memory option, so even they join in all the time. But what after it? You know, it's like after climbing Mount Everest. When you look up, you see the sky and the stars. There is no way up, there is no ladder. And there are no limits to what you can do. There is infinite space. And here comes the pertinent question. What after clearing CA? And today with me is Chirag sir again. Chirag sir, thank you for joining us.
Thanks, Anirudh. And it's always been a pleasure to talk to you, and on the topics which are most relevant, most required to the mass. So I like the topic you pick up. It's going to be a good day today.
Yeah. Starting it simply, what after clearing it? What is there to be done? What's the work?
That's, I think, a very different thing. As you mentioned, when you clear the exams, you feel you are on the Mount Everest. You cleared it and, you've won. But when you reach the Everest, you see that the sky is much above you. And that's where you want to be, on the top of the world, not on the Everest. And that's the life after CA. So I like to discuss this topic, life after CA. I would like to tell you what are the options available after once you become a chartered accountant. Which field can you go into? It could apply to those also who are semi-qualified, maybe today trying to climb that Everest. And how, what you can do as on today, what are the options available? There's a lot of things which comes up to me, and I will discuss those with you. And to start with, the favorites of all why chartered accountants is all about audits. So, there are various stratas in which, a chartered accountant can apply for once he has cleared, or maybe while he's selecting his articleship itself these days. Because articleship also has become specialized these days. It's not about getting experience of everything, but it's about getting an experience, but then selecting your way forward as an expert. So, I will describe today what are the avenues available in audits, taxation, transaction advisory, which is a coin term today, which is glamour, which everybody wants to join in. What's it all about? And now with the lot of new startups coming up, lot of new ideas coming up, the things have evolved where there are other specialized areas have evolved. So we will discuss about various avenues, stratas, which I will brief you about what's that all about. And within those stratas, what kind of work, comes to a chartered accountant or a semi-qualified. Many times, people are excited when they clear a chartered accountant. What would be the package I get? So, a brief about that as well, we will cover during this talk. And I will maybe to the best of my knowledge, what I know about industry, been in industry for 20 years now, and what are the packages we offer today. We being a startup, I have gone through my journey where I have been with Big Four. I have been with corporates like, top corporates, which are in Fortune 500 today. I have worked with Indian mid-sized firms, big-sized firms. And today I have my own consultancy practice. So in all of this field, what are the offerings today for a chartered accountant to, have his life after CA? There are people who migrate from various states to, metros to make their life big or up. So we will discuss something about tier one, tier two cities also, where you stay in tier two, where you've cleared your chartered, or do you want to move to a metro and what's life over there for a chartered accountant? So this is what I briefly plan to cover. And obviously, if there is something more you feel like getting covered in this session, then we will take it up post that. Mm-hmm. When you look for audit, which is you know considered by the base for a chartered accountant, and you know serve to the nation, and you are a part of your the service to the country back. Audits come the forefront, and you know when you talk about audits, it's not only the audits where you sign the balance sheet. There are various kind of audits which is that wherein chartered accountant can be a part of, either all of them or sometimes you specialize in particular field. Like to start with, you have statutory audits, you know, where you can, which is always there for a chartered accountant. Then you have internal audits where you can join. There are these days coming up is IT audit, where you can clear DISA or maybe CISA after your chartered accountancy and be a part of IT audits or IT infrastructures developments. There are management audits, which are specifically audited by management when you join a corporate. Mm-hmm. The corporate have their internal team either to do internal audits or management specific audits when sometimes they have received complaints or they want to do specific area coverage for the board and all. Mm-hmm. And then these days, another term which has been coined is the forensic audits.
Yeah.
So where you know you audit the frauds where there are some signals already there, you then go and audit them. So this are some of the kind of stratas which are available if you want to select the field of audit. Going into, I'll give some brief about each stratas, so you have a brief idea. We will not go into much detail today,
yeah,
because every strata can have one session, you know. So, but we'll go with the brief of it. So to start with, we have, let's say, the statutory audit.
Yeah.
See, in statutory audit, you have, this day's Big Four. You have mid-size or the small size firms or big Indian firms. And then you have proprietaries who are doing the audits. So, where to enter, what to do is obviously choice of an individual. What I am going to share today is the background about this, so you can make your individual choices when you want to move forward in your careers.
Yeah.
So obviously, when Big Four, if you'll take today, Big Four is where, these days there is further specialization in audits, where you have manufacturing team, you have a team to audit the BFSI clients, like the banking and insurance financial sector. You have TICE, which is telecom, entertainment, media sector. So, they have divided within audits also into stratas. If you go somewhere to a mid-sized firm or an Indian firm, you might not find such stratas within stat audit, but you may be a part of a stat audit. Whereas in some big firms, you may be a part of, they get empaneled with a lot of government audits. So you could be part of that, or you could be a private sector audit team. That could be the most. Otherwise, the team is generally common in an Indian mid-sized firms.
Mm-hmm.
And proprietary, obviously, you have less number of chartered. So anything and everything is a part to it. So that's about the stat audit piece in a Big Four, a mid-size. And sometimes many people ask me also about the package. So obviously Big Four these days, what I have seen, Big Six, if you put it, is in the range for a fresher from 6.5 to 8 lakhs.
Yeah.
And then obviously you keep moving up the ladder based on your performances and other thing. If you are in tier one, sometimes when you are in tier two, maybe you can reduce this by another 50,000 or 75,000, and that would be your yearly package. If you go to a mid-size firm, anywhere between 4.5 lakhs to 7.5 lakhs is general trend of a package. Obviously, it could be more or less depending upon the firms. Tier 2 city, again, you can just discount it by, let's say, 10% or 15%, because standard of livings and other things are different there.
Mm-hmm.
And, so those are when you're part of a stat audit team.
Yeah.
Moving forward, we have the internal audit. So the package is more or less for a Big Four, and mid-sized firm will remain same. Wherever the corporate comes in, I will describe just the general packages about corporates as well.
Okay.
So now you have internal audits. Again, internal audit are divided into, you have Big Four, you have mid-size. Here you also have a corporate coming in, because statutory audit is independent, so you don't have corporates having statutory audit teams. But internal audit, the entities could have an internal team where the internal audit head reports directly to those charged with governance, which is the audit committee or the board. And you have an in-house internal audit team also in a big corporate. Small corporates, they outsource the internal audit if required or if they want to voluntarily go for. But big corporates generally have their in-house teams. Mm-hmm. So you can be a part of that in-house internal audit teams also. And when you go to corporates, again, your package, you know, your CTC are generally higher, but our on hands are lower. But still somewhere anywhere in the range of 7.5 to 10, somewhere 11. Okay. Obviously, I'm keeping aside the rankers, you know, because that's a different strata. But yeah. I'm talking about is a general package which you get. And obviously, when you go for campus or even for a direct interviews. Mm-hmm. So those are generally the packet scales also. And those are the kind of work you do. So where you have statutory audit, where you do your independent audits, clients keep changing. Internal audit, you are, if with a firm, client keeps changing, you get new exposures. Mm-hmm. If you are with a corporate, it's kind of a job which is more, you know, stabilized or a stable job. Mm-hmm. But once even in corporate, when you select a particular strata,
yeah,
you are going to like you know, you join an insurance industry in internal audit.
Yeah.
More or less, your career could be a part of an internal audit in an insurance industry. Banking, then you may have banking NBFCs. You may keep mm-hmm. changing entities. But generally, we have seen that you then spend your life over there. And then you have general manufacturing corporates.
And then the question comes up about upward movement.
Yeah. So then you have lateral movements as well. And that's where people move from one entity to another mm-hmm. also many times to go up the ladder. But as you are a fresher, the important part is to gain experience, to gain a good profile.
Yeah.
You know, rather than jump or thinking about a ladder right now, maybe mm-hmm. 3 years, 4 years down your career, you can think about where I'll get a growth. Mm-hmm. And obviously, once you're part of a corporate, even your individual consultancy in the end, if you want to pursue, mm-hmm. is open for you. Yeah. So that's on the IT audit, on the internal audit part. Then comes the IT audit. Now, IT and internal audit are also going hand in hand today. There is a lot of digitalization we've been seeing happening all around us. Mm-hmm. You know, artificial intelligence is everywhere of these days. And so sooner or later, you will see that IT is either an independent audit or it's going to be part of the internal audit and a strong component of an internal audit or a risk management. Mm-hmm. So IT audit is another strata where you might have to go for DISA or CISA and pursue that to have more detailed knowledge about IT,
yeah.
the in-depth about it. And this is one field which again is opened up in terms of big firms. Mid-sized firm has a less kind of vacancies for this kind of a profile
mm-hmm.
because it's very specific. But big six and on the other side, corporates have a huge demand for, you know, CA with an IT knowledge. There is one very niche field over here, which we have seen in our career is, you know, where there are ERP implementations.
Yes.
There are audits also required once you implement. So the mm-hmm. ERP implementing entities or corporates also hire chartered accountant to do this audit because it helps them improving their quality every time.
Mm-hmm.
So they are part of that implementation team blended and they keep doing internal audits for that, you know, entity where they do implementation of ERPs. So this is one niche field, but it's been growing. It's been very well paid field and, you know, where there are a lot of travel options because if you are part of SAP implementation, Oracle implementations, you have to go to virtually
every branch and test if everything is working and the integration is done properly.
Right. Absolutely.
And here, the another aspect is security.
Yeah. That's
extremely there, but chartered accountants are not that much in there because they prefer engineers because hacking and all, they do that. CISA is very special in that part because many of the people do are engineers now. There is also CISSP is also there.
Very true.
Euro Union especially.
Right. So then comes the management internal audits or, you know, where management likes to do some vendor audits,
mm-hmm.
some contracts audit, some expenditure audit, you know, like you have a metro project and you want to have an internal team to keep and check on it and audit on the expenditures which happen. Or you are into real estate sector and you want, you know, the entire huge projects we see, you know, coming up these days, you want an in-house team to do specific audits.
Mm-hmm.
Or you are into retail, hospitality, you want some specific audits to be done for management comforts, or we call it as revenue assurance audit many times.
Mm-hmm.
So you can be a part of this team as well in terms of having internal audits. And the last field which we talked about was a forensic audit, which is coming up big time these days. We've been hearing a lot about it, and it's going to be there. So far as you know, fundings are there, forensic audit is going to be there. And if you want to develop you know, in this field also, even our institute has devised a separate you know, course for it, which is called FAFT. You can you know, enroll and maybe get that certificate, or you have CFE, which I think you yourself are running today, and you are seeing a big growth in that field in future. So that's another package which you know, you can go for. In terms of packages, maybe forensic audit could be a little bit more remunerative in today's time, because it's a specialized skill.
Plus with IBC and this recent SEBI empanelment, they are showing much more interest in this.
So this is one field which you can also deep dive into as a specific career field in forward. Obviously, we have due diligences. I will take it up, which could be a part of audit, but I'll take it up in the transaction advisory service when I talk about, which will give you more idea, because it's more related to acquisitions, M&As. So that is one thing in the field of audits. Coming to another favorite area of chartered accountants, tax. So though I am not part of tax, I was more part of audit before, and now consultancy and advisory and transaction advisory. But tax is something which we've also seen as a field which is evolving today. You know, you would have seen a lot of chartered accountants moving into indirect tax field when GST came in. They set up their new entire new practices. A lot of you know, freshers could make up their practices because it was an evolving area. So nobody had an experience in terms of very specific to GST. Obviously, there were service tax, customs, various acts before, but nobody had. And hence, you know, that has also been a new field. But in terms of tax, if we pick up, the stratas are divided into individual taxation, which a lot of our, you know, seniors had their practice entirely set up on individual return filings, individual, you know, they help the individuals to plan their tax plannings and stuff. And so that's where they had had their huge practice. They had huge number of individuals. There are several firms which do individual returns in terms of for employees. So there is mass, there is volume.
The entire payroll value, they file.
Yes, the value per return is less, but the volume has
volume,
to be
you can manage
to...
that. With computerization and all, it's much faster now.
So that is one area, but today it's not glamorous. It's happening more in tier three cities. Now, tier one, tier two people don't want to file individual returns anymore. They, because it's automized also, as you said.
The utility is also there now. ITR ones are virtually, you can do it yourself. 26A's in department also allows that now.
So those are the fields where that is one field where, you know, individual return filing starts from 5,000 per return to somewhere 2 lakh per return also for an HNI or more than that. So, but the average trend is 15 to 25,000 I have seen. So it's not very remunerative, but the mass is big. And hence, you know, overall, you may be able to have a good practice in that area as well. Coming certain people with individual also have corporate tax filings, or there are specific people who do corporate filings. Corporate filings, as you know, are a little bit more complex. It requires more skills in depth, more experience, you know, because their issues are more complex and wider. And obviously, since complexity is higher, remuneration is higher, your time spent is higher. And hence, you know, it could be more remunerative in terms of could be right from 50,000. It can go up to even 7, 8, 10 lakhs, you know, where you can also pick up tax audit as a part of it. So that is another thing. Another
tax
area
audit is complementary to stat audit in many, many cases, because it's virtually the same work. You're just filing the return. Especially in the lower
Several lower end clients, they don't, you know, many times have a requirement of a stat audit like LLPs and all, but they still have to do a tax audit. So many times, you know, because there are exemption limits given, but even if you're below that exemption limit, maybe a tax audit is applicable.
Because so, for loans and all, they do ask you to file tax audits even if you're below the limit.
So that's another area you can look for. The another upcoming area which I have seen individuals are specializing in is international taxation and transfer pricing. So, you know, includes FEMA regulations and other stuffs. But this is one area which is picking up where I have seen individuals, you know, have setting up a whole practice in this particular area itself, because it is very remunerative one. But it requires complexities. There are treaties between entities which you should be aware of while guiding your client. And now, you know, a lot of funds are moving from internationally to India. Everybody wants to invest in India, and hence this field is going to be a boom very soon. You know, we're hearing about BEPS consultancies. We are hearing about FEMA consultancies, FATCA coming in. All of these new regulations are a new avenues of practice for chartered accountants. So this is another area where you can look for in terms of taxation if you want to specialize in. Another new area which is very good and coming up for young chartered accountants is assessments. It has become faceless. You know, you require a lot of drafting skills to reply.
Yes.
Good English, good drafting skills, good understanding of, you know, the
plus
act.
You need a lot of research work to do that, because you don't know which case law can help you.
Absolutely. So there are tools which support you, but still the, you know, this faceless with a lot of IT involvement, using of IT infrastructure to file all this, you know, replies and all. It's a good avenue for, you know, young chartered accountants to jump into, and which could become bigger in the near future, because now, you know, you don't have to visit income tax offices, but, you know, you can just go on this basis. And this area, people are charging on hourly basis also, like a lawyer.
Because
it could be... It could be assignment based or hourly based.
And the research work is extremely important, because I used to draft letters during my earlier days. And that one small activity of drafting a letter to the income tax department required hours. Because you'll have to find 6-7 case laws, and you have to check whether it has been overruled or not also.
Absolutely. So that is one area or avenue again you can look for. Coming to another one is more on the compliance, the tax compliance side. Many times you want to be like, you know, you have indirect taxes, a lot of compliances, a direct taxes, filing of TDS returns, professional tax returns on a monthly basis, quarterly basis. So these are a lot of compliances which are there in direct or indirect tax. And even GST returns requires you to, you know, match your GST returns. Yes. There are reconciliations with books of accounts. So this is also one area of, you know, revenue assurance as well as compliance, which could be blended together and could be a field by itself today for a chartered accountant, because the volume of transactions are pretty big here. So even, you know, 1, 2, or 3 clients on retainership basis can have you your office run. And then you can have another clients who are premium topped up on that. So this is one field where, again, you're, you know, anywhere as a retainer, because this is an area where people hire you as retainer. Which is very good for young chartered accountants or practicing CAs to have this field. If you have, you know, person who hires you on retainership basis, your risk of earning your basic revenue goes off. So these are the areas where you can target if you want to have basic revenues and then top up yourself onto it. So GST obviously is one picking up big area in terms of compliances. And that is one area you can look for as your individual practice. Obviously, TDS filings and all is not an individual practice. It's blended with the tax practice. But GST is an independent practice. You can do customs. Many people are dealing in customs and excise even today. So that's another area of practice under tax.
And the thing is always about compliance, because government of India is known to increase compliance many times if transactions are going well. And I remember that 15 CACD, one year they just said, notified that all people doing tax audit must comply with 15 CACD if they are doing any foreign remittance. And we had an entire pile of files just because of that. Within 1 month, compliance increased like anything.
So these are some of the areas. Obviously, in terms of this advisory in human resource department, so salary. You know, that's also a field I have seen. There are few experts, but there are very few. But the field is vast where, you know, you guide corporates to do a proper tax planning for their employees. You know, where it saves tax for their employees with a proper tax planning. So there are several schemes, exemptions available under the act, which could be well blended. And it could be another way where your employees get more higher on hand salary to spend. So, and which is very much a requirement of these days where we are standing today, post-corona, the liquidity is the key in the hands of everybody. So that's one field which is going to evolve big time now. So that's area where, you know, a young or a fresher or you know, a few years experience chartered accountants can look for, or also firms can look for who have specialized in this area.
Yeah.
So that's more a brief about audit and tax, which is common for all.
Mm-hmm.
You know, where you feel that you becoming a chartered accountant for that.
Mm-hmm.
But now we will pick up certain field which are you know, tangent to this myth of, you know, you are, if you are a chartered accountant, you are doing audit or tax. It's not so.
It's actually harassment now. If you're a CA, then people will come with your tax queries. File kara do, I don't work in income tax.
Right. So there is much a need of, you know, even the corporates, even the CEOs or the CFOs to know that a chartered accountant has various other options which
yes.
they can kill from.
Yes.
So now we'll pick up certain tangent services which a lot of people are practicing today. They have made this practice huge
mm-hmm.
in few years, and how it's grown and what are these avenues. So let's talk about transaction advisory services.
Mm-hmm.
TAS, as it's commonly known in the Big Six environment, and you know, when you're presenting your skills, it's called as TAS, it's Transaction Advisory Services, which has a big gamut, but we'll pick a few of the avenues where, you know, you can look forward for. So as we know, transaction advisory service many times is related with M&As, which are happening big time today.
Mm-hmm.
It's related to IPO services, which is, you are seeing every,
yeah.
you know, new day, a new IPO.
Nykaa just did it last week. And plus,
right.
India has the most number of unicorns now.
Yes, yes. That's one avenue. Mm-hmm. Then you have SPAC, which is coming up, special purpose acquisition companies, which, you know, is growing big in US, and soon we are going to see in India. So that's another practice in transaction advisory. And there are other advisory services in terms of due diligence, if you are part of audit, tax advisory or tax plannings or tax structurings, as we call, in terms of if you are in tax expert,
mm-hmm.
or transfer pricing advisory if you are an international tax expert, because money is flowing, or subsidiaries, parent mergers, acquisitions happening.
Mm-hmm.
Gap advisory is another big element in transaction advisory, where you know, because people from different countries are investing money, your parent could be somewhere outside India, so you will have to do a local gap as well as an international gap. Could be an US gap, could be an UK IFRS, EU IFRS,
yeah.
You know, Ind AS migrations from your local Indian gaps. All of this could become a part of this advisory service initially,
mm-hmm.
Where you guide the client to move towards it. Even IPO requires 5 years restatements of your financial statement, 3 years restatement
yes.
of your financial statements. So that's another element which is a part of transaction advisory services,
mm-hmm.
where you guide a client or a customer or a corporate to basically prepare for their IPOs. So within that, obviously due diligence is known to all, where you have financial due diligence, you have legal due diligence, you have company secretarial due diligence.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously you have a team which is blend of chartered accountants, lawyers, company secretaries. So CA most probably are look forward towards financial and tax due diligence. So that's one area. If you are a chartered accountant, obviously salary package again ranges in a similar range. Transaction advisory sometimes pay you 10% more than statutory or a tax expert in terms of job. Then comes, you know, the in the transaction advisory, these days we are seeing is internal controls, which are picking up, where investors wants you to have good controls. And hence, you know, they ask you to have a team member who is also an expert in controls setting up.
Yeah.
Because when they invest money, they want the you know, investee to have proper controls, and that's where entities are calling for advisory services to set up good controls as well.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if you're looking for US listing, you even have Sarbanes-Oxley or SOX 404 to comply with, which is big. So
mm-hmm.
those all can become a part of your advisory or specialized services area. IPO, obviously, restatement of 5 years, you know, drafting of financial prospectus, a lot of areas where you can guide. There are a lot of support and certifications required when you go for an IPO. Even certification could be a part. Most of them are required from a stat audit, but there could be, apart from stat auditors, also maybe certain certificates by a professional. So that is one area you can go for. SPAC listing, as I said, it is kind of a reverse merger listing, which is happening on big time. Now, and with a lot of unicorns coming up, SPAC would be another route for them to get easily listed.
SPAC is the easiest way to get listed, right? It's been done before. It used to be done with reverse mergers. Again, it was where people were detecting fraudulent activity. So to make it better, they turned to SPAC.
Right. So even, yes, there are still, SPAC is also evolving. It's not fully stabilized. But yes, sooner or later, we may see a similar change, some changes in it, but a day of light very soon.
Yeah.
Then you have M&A advisory, which is pretty common. A lot of people are dealing into it. Big fours have huge teams into M&A advisories,
mm-hmm.
which is a part of transaction where, you know, right from reviewing the agreements, drafting of agreements, commercial terms, all of this, you advise a client in terms of amalgamation. So that's another area where it's picking up. So more of on the transaction advisory, obviously IB equity research are all part, which is also where chartered accountants can get job into corporates or, you know, IB industry. Investment banking is also part of more of advisory services or specialized areas.
Hmm.
So that's about another cream area where chartered accountants are being looked forward for to share their experience and knowledge. Another few specialized areas which have come up in or evolved in recent future where, you know, chartered accountants can look for are some, I will tell you, they were happening in smaller scale, but now it's happening on very big scale with, you know, changes in industry funding, all of this thing happening. So one is accounting and bookkeeping, where also people have specialized, you know, there are people who are especially working only in this area and chartered accountants,
mm-hmm.
Where you know, you require to hire a lot of number of people below you, but obviously it's again a volume practice than a value practice. But, you know, bookkeeping, like I have seen big corporates
mm-hmm.
Who come from US to India, you know, they have their engineers, developers, infrastructure or front-end people in India, but entire back office is outsourced. Entire bookkeeping and compliance is outsourced.
Mm-hmm.
There are big firms in India who are, you know, advisory firms who deal only into this practice where they help you to set up the entity. They take care of your accounts. They take care of your compliances. They take care of your audits.
Okay.
We will make sure that, you know, your statutory auditors are satisfied and get your audits also done properly on a timely basis. So this is one practice where a lot of foreign investors are looking into for that. You know, this is one kind of thing. We don't want to set up an entire accounts department here. We just outsource this to somebody. So it's a cost benefit as well as expertise comes in. Now, another big another area linked to this is HR payroll processing, which is also big in terms of volume. So there are a lot of people who deal with recruitments and, you know, payroll processing. Though not a very, very clear field for chartered accountants, more for MBA.
Mm-hmm.
But still, we've seen a lot of chartered accountants setting up these practices these days in the other specific areas. Now, another key evolving area is, you know, virtual CFO.
Yeah.
I'll spend a couple of minutes on this because it is very much evolving with a lot of startups
mm-hmm.
coming up, a lot of MNCs growing, money coming in into Indian entities, even family houses. Now, you don't have a specialized CFO, or many times you cannot afford a CFO, which is, you know, anywhere ranging between 3 lakhs a month to 5 to 6 lakhs a month.
Yeah.
Now, you might not be able to afford this, and hence a new area of practice which evolved in last few years and which is now growing big time is virtual CFO, where or a sharing CFO, part-time CFO, these are the terms coined. A virtual CFO is somebody, you know, who keeps an eye on your entire financial statement. So you have an accounts team, but you don't have a head, which you cannot afford for 5 lakhs. So a virtual CFO will come with a retainership, which is lesser than that 3 lakhs or 5 lakhs,
mm-hmm.
which, you know, you might would have paid to a full-time CFO. And, you know, he keeps a complete watch through online, as well as whenever the visits are required on a frequent basis on between you both, as you decide, he will visit and review all the stuff. This area has picked up big time during COVID
mm-hmm.
because, you know, and that's where the virtual CFO term coined up, where, you know, you can online also monitor it with meetings, with sharing data, with, you know, Microsoft Teams giving Google giving you those options available. So you can use those workplaces. You have a lot of sharing tools now, secure tools. You have online meeting, video conferencing tools. You can use all of them and be a virtual CFO. Where, you know, you can be a CFO for 3, 4, 5 entities. You can increase your staff and do virtual CFO services for multiple entities.
Mm-hmm.
And there are various entities in this field. Here you are paid also well. You earn also pretty well. And it's a win-win situation for corporates, for advisory firms, all of them.
Yeah.
So this is one field which is picking up. It has its own model methodologies, which obviously requires a separate session. But overall, this is the area where, again, as a virtual CFO, as a retainer, you can earn anywhere between 1 lakh to 3 lakh or 4 lakhs per month as a retainer. And, you know, you can have two or three clients, which helps you to then earn much more. Another term which these days we have seen is people wants extended board. Now, this is new field coming up for chartered accountants, obviously a little bit experienced chartered accountants, where, you know, all the homegrown entities are looking for an extended professional board. Earlier, we used to have members from our families on board. Now, it's all changed. Compliances have changed. Things have changed. You need to give exam to become a director. So, or you can become an advisor to an MD or a CEO. So, you know, these days we are advising a lot of boards, a lot of MDs and executives. We are independent directors on board. Now, this is the field which is evolving big time. There, you know, the fees are anywhere a retainership. If you are advisory to the board, if you are independent director, they pay you per meeting charges also. Or per hour charges also are this there are the models to earn in this area, and which is a very good earning. But here you require a good amount of exposure and experience before you jump into this field. So this is for somebody who is experienced enough, or you know, especially those who are planning to retire. Retire bankers who have very good experience can be looking into this field if they are chartered accountants or have this financial background knowledge. Retired practitioners who have closed down their practices now because you know, they are not been able to digitalize or they are not been able to cope up with this fast growth. They could be advisors to a lot of MD sharing their whole experiences. So this is one area where you can look for. Another area as virtual CFO, there is also a field called support CFO now. So people are supporting the CFO rather than, you know, replacing the CFO. So, you know, you have a lot of banking compliances, you have a lot of other compliances where CFO has not been able to give time because he's been asked to move to a strategic role also in the corporate. All this area, which are more of mechanical, can also be put on to somebody who can support a CFO. Like CFO needs to do a lot of research. He doesn't have time to do research when he's, you know, presenting to the board. So he may have a support team, which is generally called as executive team to CFO or executive assistant to CFO. Now, this is also one field where CFOs are picking up chartered accountants, CEO are picking up chartered accountants. Because when they have to present to the independent board, they also need to do a lot of research for their competitors, market, and other things. So there they have a support team to support the CFO.
Again, this is just strengthening the first line of defense. Lastly, we had talked about the fact that auditors are the last line, but now we are being promoted to the first line, which can help it immensely. Compliance, especially, so
auditors still stand the last line, but chartered accountants
come to the first line.
Right.
Hey, we are so, almost synonymous.
Yes.
In India, it's auditor and chartered accountant are synonymous now.
That's where I said that there are a lot of other avenues, and you know, it's not only about audits. Another area which is coming up a big time is financial re-engineering, where you re-engineer the entire way the finances are being used in an entity. Even the systems, the processes are being re-engineered to bring in a lot of efficiency, a lot of cost benefit, you know, increasing a lot of values of the entity to from the investor's perspective, where you can, you know, gain more of value towards it. Like, you know, you have a house and you want to sell. So there is a different pricing if you have a well-furnished house or a semi-furnished house. It is something like that, where you just spend some more money and furnished your house value will be much more than you expect. Similarly happens when you want to sell a second-hand car, right? You want to sell them, you will refurbish them, you will color them, and you will, you know, prepare it for selling. So it gives you a little bit more higher value than you are spending, and which is your income when you actually are looking for investors. So this is one area which is picking up big time. Another area, digitalization of processes, which are coming up, where, you know, you have IT experts, as I said, blended with chartered accountants team. So you need CA, because if you are digitalizing a process, yes, the IT guys will write the code, but what is the input
testing
and what is the output required?
The
so the key is, what is the output required? Yes, testing comes to the audit, which we already discussed about. But what in implementation, what is the output required? Now that is what a chartered accountant will explain to an IT guy. And, you know, he will implement it and you again do a quality or a user testing. about it. So digitalizing is one. Another area which is picking up these days, I have seen a lot of young people moving into it, is ESG, which is going to be mandatory for few entities from next year.
Yeah.
And then, you know, more entities. So that is another field where young chartered accountants can look for in developing their practices in near future. So you may have some retainership or stat audit or tax audit as your routine. And then you can, you know, look into such fields and avenues for your premium services and, you know, growth.
Yeah.
So that is one. You have another areas like valuations where chartered accountants are a part of. Though you have valuation exams now where you have to give that exam and get that certificate before you do certain kind of valuations.
Yes.
But valuations also where chartered accountants can look for. There is a gap advisory, as I said. So gap audits are there, but also advisory. There are people who specifically advise in IFRS, US gap or Indian gap implementation. So that's one area. Another key area where chartered accountants have launched their practices, and I've seen few youngsters starting a startup, is preparation of investor deck. A lot of people want fund from bank and from investors, but investors need data to before putting in money. So there is an entire investor deck and a teaser, valuation models, which you have to present to the investors. Now you're again highly experienced chartered accountants, or, you know, young chartered accountants under the guidance of experienced chartered accountant can develop this field.
Yeah.
And these are all going to be a niche field. You can practice in it for your whole, you know, career, and you will make good amount of revenues. And there is a lot of growth. As you said, sky is the limit earlier in your opening remarks. This is what the sky or the universe is, and not the Everest, or, you know, we talk about. There is something beyond the sky as well.
A lot beyond.
Which you said in here. So these are all the avenues and fields which you can pick up and, you know, look forward for. So I have given some brief. Obviously there are many more, you know, chartered accountant going into professions or teaching field. Chartered accountants are doing a lot of startups today, you know, in education field, in even, you know, we have a lot of travel apps which are, you know, formed by chartered accountants. We have a lot of startups in fintech, which are by chartered accountants and IT guys together. So those are, yes, other fields, but those are still, you know, contingent fields, risky fields. But other all fields, HR, you may take payroll processing, advisories. These are all stabilized field, and you can make a good amount of practice within this area itself in tier one, tier two, or tier three cities today. So this is what is the whole gamut of CA, which I wanted to bring to light. And I would, you know, be happy to share something more if you have thoughts on all about it.
All right. So that was very enlightening, and it's much, much more than anybody normally thinks that what a CA can do.
Right.
Yeah. So let's just look at some other things also. So firstly, okay, what went through your mind when you cleared all those years back?
So obviously the first thought in my life always when I cleared and I sat, you know, alone after celebrating for a couple of days, what should I be doing in my life? Yeah, because I had my articleship, which was not over at that point in time. So I had to still do that. So I had time to think about. So I had always been doing stat audit and a little bit of tax exposure in my articleship days. But when I move forward, the only thing I had in my mind is I want to do something where I get good profile experience. And then I always think forward and think big. So my idea was always to think what's next or what's after this, and continue what I'm doing, but prepare for what's after that. So in my journey, obviously, I started with a Big Four. Then when I saw that, you know, when I went international on behalf of Big Four on a secondment, I saw the world is quite bigger and different out there in my earlier days. And that's where I saw there is much more internationally than what we see in India. And so I joined a conglomerate, which is more in more than, I think, 150 countries that point in time, which were doing M&As. So I was part of M&A's advisory team, a migration team where we acquire an entity and migrate it to our world, our company's world, in terms of finance, in terms of operations, and then do a compliance check next year. So we had SAP implementation globally for, you know, all the entities. We my company did an acquisition. So I traveled around the globe to see that and implement IFRS, which was globally been implemented by that entity that time. which was going to come in India after 3-4 years. So 2007-8, I did this. And so again, when IFRS came in, I was doing IFRS, but preparing for IFC, which was internal financial control coming in. Mm-hmm. When internal financial control came in, we had an upper hand because we were already prepared in the firm. Mm-hmm. When we were implementing IFC, we prepared for forensics. And then forensics evolved when the new government came in, the frauds broke out. So we had a team which was capable enough to jump from day one because they were prepared well with all tools and techniques. Mm-hmm. When we did for forensics, you know, I thought advisory is the next piece. And so I started preparing for advisory where I am today. Mm-hmm. And we are doing virtual CFO, we are doing forensic supports, we are doing IPO supports, we are doing SPAC listings today outside India. Mm-hmm. We are doing forensics globally. So that is now what is running, and we are preparing for financial reengineering, which is the next termed or coined termed, which is going to be in future. So yeah, we are preparing for that financial reengineering now. I'm preparing a team for it. Let's see how it evolves after 2-3 years when all these entities who have got money would, you know, like to, the investors would like to see that the money are channelized properly and efficiently used. Mm-hmm. So that is what is going to be the next trend very soon. So we are preparing, we are eyeing that and we are preparing. So always think forward and think big was the aim. And I kept doing it and that's where I am today. So that's the whole idea.
Yeah, that's great to know.
That's my journey and my thought process behind this.
No, because looking forward is always, you know, at the beginning, after clearing, there is this eternal question whether you should practice or whether you should go into industry. And that risk is always in our head. Because generally, people who have actually their parents have started accountants, they just join the family business. But for the rest of the people, you know, they have this question, you know. And I see that nobody practices. Because at the beginning, there's that fear. And is it worth it, you know? I mean, how many years, I mean?
No, so see, again, there are ways and models which we have seen when we have a huge network. We've seen people coming where, as you said, you know, father had a chartered accountancy firm and the son coming in. But the son who has grown the firm also, we know many of them, and went into another avenues. But we've seen that initially they have gone and taken exposure in another firm's big fours, corporates, wherever. But they have taken some 2-3 years exposure, 4 years exposure, and then came back and jumped into it. That's a good way or model we've seen, you know, to adopt for, rather than becoming a partner day one as you clear in your firm and having less experience. Mm-hmm. So I would always say gain profile, gain experience, and this is always there for you. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there is one thing which is set up, but you need to grow rather than continuing. Now it's the era of growth, not of continuing what you have. So that's where is the field. And obviously industry or practice, it's an individual choice. Mm-hmm. Practice has risk, but it's remunerative, sky is the limit. When you are in a corporate or a job, it's a secured kind of a payment, which still today has not completely been secured, which was thought as secured, has changed the tables. But still it's considered a 9-to-6 job, which is still not today for chartered accountants at least. You know, you are still spending nights when your MIS is coming or, you know, you have your audits going on. So, but still it's looked forward from a more, you know, job, which is more secure, time driven, every day, you know, going to the same place, knowing what to do. It's a system process set up. You are a part of a system. So no risk. So if you have a less risk taking ability, go to corporates, you know, though there is risk in it, but still practice has much higher you know, risk. So you need to have a risk-taking capability over there. But yes, you can take experience in a mid-sized firm or a big four and then look forward for your practice rather than from day one jumping into practice. Mm-hmm. So that's the idea. That's the model.
Yeah. And so working, you know, people just start working for some corporates, but there's always this question that whether you should work in a firm like a big four and get a lot of experience in that particular area or join a company and work in-house, because people always think about upward movement later. That one creates a difference.
Today, I will tell you that, you know, as I said, the big four CA firms or corporate firms or, you know, firms in India are also moving towards thought processes like a corporate, where they pull up an entire advisory team. Now, you can be part of that and have an experience of a corporate, or at the same time, as I said, it all depends on your risk-taking ability, your thought process. What do you want? So it's on a platter, you know. Some people like South Indian, some people like North Indian. Both food are good. it's what you like, but it depends on what you've done in your articleship. What's your vision, your goal to be in life? You want to take that risk, you want to jump into it. What stage of life you are? You know, people are moving from corporate to practice. People are moving from practice to corporate. Grass is always greener on the other side, which is a universal statement, still holds good today. Right. But as I said, if you should have a vision, you should know what's next. If you have that vision, if you know what's next, advisory, corporate, your own firm, your partnership firms are the take today. But if you can't have that vision, you don't want to do all those things. Corporate, obviously there is growth in corporates as well. CFOs are making good money. Mm-hmm. From CFOs, now CEO is an avenue which is opened for CFO. Several MDs are now from CA, chartered accountancy background. So those fields which were not open for chartereds also have opened up for chartereds in corporates. Mm-hmm. So even sky is the limit there. We've seen a lot of corporates from banks. They're moving out and starting their own entities at an age. Nykaa was one of the examples you gave. There are a lot of such who were part of some another system, started their own and have grown. So now things are different. Earlier, never somebody thought that I could also have an entrepreneurship. Mm-hmm. Now entrepreneurship has given this avenue where the sky has, you know, the limits have crossed the sky also. So it doesn't matter which field you are now, but select where your likings are. Switch is also possible in earlier years of your life. But obviously you will have to plan your vision or have your mentor who guides you through this process.
Because a big fear with many people is that once you pick a particular field, that becomes to define you because you have experience in that field. And later switching becomes extremely difficult because wherever you put an application, they're like, you only have experience in this area. Why are you coming here?
True. So we've been facing that. And there is a solution to that also. But what happens many times people in corporate, they have started their EMIs on cars, loans, where, you know, it's difficult for them to move. Otherwise, what happens is, yes, if you're part of insurance industry in beginning, generally you will switch into another insurance entity. If you're part of banking, you will switch within banking and NBFCs or financial sector. If you're part of manufacturing, yes, obviously, because if I am hiring somebody with 5 years experience and I'm paying for it, I'm hiring for him for his experience, right?
Yes.
So I would want him to continue to do that work. But, you know, today people want to do different things and try the other elements. So because people have become more risk takers these days, you know, our curriculum itself is now, you know, moving towards open book, which shows that, you know, there is a risk taking ability and not that you have to mug up something and go and apply. So things are evolving. People are ready to take this risk. And when you look for a movement, then look for a movement and not financial growth also. What's happening today with many people are, you know, I want to move, but I want a 25% rise also. And I want to change my profile also. Now people are hiring you for your experience and pay it. So if you are ready to come 25% low, I think market is open for you with your experience and grasping powers you've done over the period. Somebody would like to invest in you, and you know there has to be a win-win situation if you want something. So be prepared for that if you want to do something. There are a lot of startups coming in. Look for that. You know, look to change your field or as a ladder to grow. You know, they are giving ESOPs, which finally, you know, runs into crores if the startup goes good. So that's the risk-taking ability which some people have today. If you don't have, then, you know, it's difficult to migrate from where you are because people pay you for your experience. And that's always the truth.
Because especially in forensics and equity research, these are two fields which people just want to get in after they're clear. And it's extremely hard because hardly anybody has experience during the articleship years about equity research or even forensic. And the only area they do get is internal and stat, and moving from there can be challenging. And the only way to do that is if you are ready to take a pay cut, then still they can consider you.
So if you want some change, you have to be prepared for that.
We have to have that foresight. And looking at this, Chirag sir, thank you for coming. Thank you for your time. And this has been very enlightening to and to everybody watching this. Please think about it. And please understand what you need. It's all about you. Please look introspect. The first thing that you do after celebrating is introspection to what you need to do in the future. Everybody out there who's out there to get a job, get one that pays the bills to your dream restaurant. And make sure that in the process, it doesn't make you lose your appetite while you enjoy your meal. All right?
So I think well summarized, Aniruddha. And then this is all about life after CA.
Yeah.
So there is much more, and keep exploring. This world is quite bigger and a lot of things to do. So a lot of young CAs, as well as those who are appearing for your exams, you know, having that dream. That's the life after CA. And I think happy to have a chat anytime, and happy to guide anybody who wants some guidance in their life. We would be happy, and is always available for them, Anurag. So
thank you very much, sir.
Thanks so much. Yeah.
Yeah.